Ayelet Shachar is Professor of Law, Political Science, and Global Affairs, and Research Chair in Citizenship and Multiculturalism at the University of Toronto Faculty of Law. Professor Shachar has received numerous excellence awards and has held research fellowships as a member of the Institute for Advanced Study at Princeton, a distinguished visiting scholar at Princeton's Law and Public Affairs Program, and Emile Noel, Senior Fellow at NYU School of Law, and the W.M. Keck Fellow in Legal Ethics and Professional Culture at Yale Law School. She's published and lectured widely on citizenship theory, immigration law, multiculturalism, cultural diversity, and women's rights, family law, and religion in comparative perspective, transnational legal ethics, highly skilled migration, and global inequality. Shachar is the author of Multicultural Jurisdictions, Cultural Differences and Women's Rights from Cambridge in 2001, which was the winner of the APSA's 2002 Foundations of Political Theory Section Best First Book Award. Beyond receiving wide scholarly recognition, this award-winning work has also proven influential in the real world, intervening in actual public policy and legislative debates in Canada and abroad. It was cited most recently by England's Archbishop of Canterbury, who described Shachar's work as, quote, highly original and significant, end quote. Ontario's Ministry of the Attorney General as well also cited it, and the Supreme Court of Canada. Wow. Her most recent book is The Birthright Lottery, Citizenship and Global Inequality from Harvard University Press in 2009, named the 2010 International Ethics Notable Book in recognition of its superior scholarship and contribution to the field of international ethics. Ayelet's talk is entitled Entangled, Gender, Religion, and Human Rights. Thanks so much for coming.
Good afternoon. Oh, it works. Bonjour, buenos dias, shalom, assalamu alaikum. Thank you very much, Carol, for this very generous introduction. It's a pleasure for me to be here, especially with my dear friend and colleague, Shayla bin Habib. So it's really a wonderful opportunity. And I want to thank the rest of the organizing committee and the students and the Mellon Fellows and everyone else who was involved in getting me here. So it's a real pleasure to be with you, and also the brave souls for being here at this late afternoon hour. Before I turn to my presentation, I have to get a sense of the room. So I just, if you don't mind, could you let me know how many people say are from philosophy? All right. Political science? Law? Oh, good. I'm not the only one. Anything else? Anyone else that I missed? Oh, political theory. Great. Anthropology, right? All right, good. So we have a wonderful multidisciplinary audience, which is very good for our discussion this afternoon. And in terms of the title of my talk, as you heard, it's Entangled, and I'll explain later on why I think gender, religion, and human rights indeed are quite deeply entangled. And not only that, I'm going to suggest that given that they are entangled in the experience, the social experience of individuals, we should also try and mirror that in the kind of legal institutional ideas that we have. So given that Shayla has given such a beautiful lecture and also has sold up the legal utopian version of law, I don't know if I fit in that. I think Shayla is actually now the most utopian among the people who believe in law, so we'll have to see whether you find my work legal utopian, but I take that as a compliment if it would fit within that trajectory. Now, in the interest of time, let me just tell you how I want to divide my talk. I'll divide it into three parts. The first part, I want to distinguish at the theoretical level between two kinds of diversity claims, which might be raised by members of minority communities. And when I talk about minority communities, I'm thinking about religious, ethnic, racial, indigenous communities, linguistic communities, but my focus will be mostly primarily on religious communities, with one exception. If I have time, I'll talk a little bit also about customary law in South Africa. If not, ask me during the Q&A. So I'm thinking about the relationship between minorities, these religious minorities, and the states in which they have settled, in which they reside, and just in the geopolitical space that I'm thinking about, all the states that I will talk about are states which are constitutionally, they're constitutional democracies, and they're also committed to the separation of state from religion. As you know, there are many countries in the world which do not follow that separation, but for the purposes of our discussion, I'll just focus on those, and you'll see partly some of the tensions arise precisely because of the notion of a strict separation, and I'll partly explore some of these boundaries and whether we need to rethink them. So the first kind of diversity claim that I will refer to, I'll call the fair inclusion claim. That's probably the familiar claim that when you're thinking about multicultural citizenship, for example, you probably have in the back of your mind. So this is the ability of minorities to be included in public spaces, by which I mean schools, workplaces, official buildings, parks, buses, subways, shopping malls, and the like. And I want to contrast this more familiar claim, the claim for fair inclusion, one which, by the way, I would include the various hijab debates that Shayla has described, I would place under this first dimension or first heading with diversity claims, that is fair inclusion. And I want to suggest to you that there's another, and I want to suggest far more difficult, complicated challenge on the horizon, again, within these contexts of claims raised by minority communities. And I will label this second kind of claim as falling under the umbrella of privatized or enclave diversity. And just to give you a hint, I'll talk about this later on, but here when I speak about these kinds of claims, I'm tracking or trying to identify partly what more religious elements within religious minority communities are now seeking or trying to encourage, if not in certain cases indirectly coerce some of their members into moving away from engagement with the secular state and its juristic institutions such as public courts and really seeking a new form of insulation and immunization from both constitutional norms and international human rights standards, and in effect asking their community members to take the route of private ordering. So this, in a way, is a whole new discourse, and in many ways I want to suggest to you that it's quite disturbing, because part of the notion that Shayla again has so nicely elucidated, the notion of iterations either occurring at the legal or the democratic sphere, in order for these to occur, they have to occur in public spaces. And part of the concern that I have is that many of the harshest or the most significant debates now about diversity are occurring under the umbrella of privatized diversity, which, as I said, I'll explain later on more specifically what I mean by that. And I want to suggest that as a principled matter, the claims of fair inclusion, the first kind of claims, when these come to the public sphere, that there are strong justifications for adopting a generous interpretation or a generous interpretive regime, if we're getting to courts, that it should be open to accepting these kinds of claims. Again, not without limitations. That is typically when we think about any kind of right, religious freedom, gender equality, any kind of right in a constitutional order which is not hierarchical, typically these rights limit each other. So there's a stretch, you can expand a right, but it would be limited once it hits another right or endangers another constitutional value or human rights protection, or in certain cases, just in the legal terminology, if there's a compelling state interest, that might again trump some kind of a protection of a right, but it doesn't mean that you're not treating the right seriously. You're stretching it as much as you can with the possibility of having some kinds of restrictions, and some constitutions, such as the Canadian and the South African and the Israeli, have within them the built-in kind of limitations. And other courts just do it through their own interpretive kind of work. And I want to suggest that if fair inclusion should be interpreted as generously as possible, I want to suggest exactly the mirror image for the second kind of claim, the privatized diversity set of claims. I don't think they should be rejected just offhand. There should be some kind of a discussion, but the basic presumption should be reversed. That is, the interpretation should be as narrow as possible, and again, I'll explain why I think that is the case. And in identifying these two kinds of claims, and more specifically their relevance or their implications for gender equality and human rights, I want to suggest that we're really faced with a much larger puzzle, and that I want you to keep in the back of your minds. That is the question of what might the new engagement, or really set of engagements, between state and religion in the 21st century look like? And to a great extent, and I think, again, this comes through very powerfully in Shayla's work and others in the room, people who have thought about the interaction between secularism and religiosity, it seems like the models that we currently have are not fully satisfactory, and indeed there is resistance to them on many layers, and many different kinds of agents are resisting them. So the question is, if we're going to have a new kind of interaction, how might it look? And the second question which I want to raise, and again, this is pushing the envelope somewhat, is asking whether if we have this new kind of arrangement or set of arrangements between state and religion in the 21st century or early 21st century, would it be possible to find a path to accommodate diversity with equality? And that's really the core challenge that I have been working on and I'm thinking through. And to some extent, I want to suggest that there's some optimistic signs, some very negative ones, but I want to suggest that at least as a principled vision looking forward, it would be quite terrific if we were able to accommodate diversity with equality. Then we would get all the values of religious diversity, say, and the examples that I will use, as well as some greater voice and protection for women's rights within religious minority communities. And indeed, I want to suggest to you that some of the most complex challenges that we're seeing today often are referred to, at least in the legal terminology, we'll refer to them as multiple or conflicting claims, meaning, and I'll just give you a few examples, that we're hardly ever dealing anymore with just one single value that is to be protected. That is, you can think about various examples of gender equality potentially conflicting or standing in tension with religious diversity. You could think about sexual orientation and freedom of association. Again, we have many cases where the two stand in conflict with one another. We have examples which are now filtering through the courts, which deal not just with the general question of either the hijab, the headscarf, or the niqab, which is the face cover, but cases which the conflicts are, again, they become more multi-layered. That is, I'm thinking about an example of a case of a woman who is a key witness in a criminal case, and she is covered, she has the niqab. Now, for anyone who knows anything about criminal law, what every criminal defense lawyer would tell you is that they want to see the facial demeanor of the person, especially when they're doing cross-investigation. So should that be a moment where, even if you have a very strong protection of religious freedom, that might be a moment where you might say, we need to find some exemptions or some kind of modification because there's a competing interest of a fair trial. So all of these kinds of competing claims are the ones that I have in the back of my mind. If you want to think about the U.S. context, one of the most significant decisions in the last that the Supreme Court gave in its last session was the one that dealt with the conflict or the tension between employment, federal employment anti-discrimination laws versus the degree of institutional autonomy that ought to be given to a church or a ministry. That's referred to as the ministerial exception or exemption case. Really complicated case. I'm happy to talk about it later on. I personally think it was not that the decision was not the most balanced one. But again, this is one of these kinds of claims. You have a strong federal protection for a workplace, in that particular case, the Americans Disability Act, versus the right of a ministry or a church to have its own internal order, relatively self-contained and not regulated by any external forces. So these are the kinds of questions which arise. And indeed, not only is this sufficiently or enough of material for us to work with, I want to suggest that the real interesting cases are the ones where you have the same plaintiff or the same party really raising two kinds of claims. That is, saying that their claim itself is intersecting. That is, a woman might be bringing a case, and you can actually think about their religious freedom cases in that sense, also the hijab cases, as raising a claim for religious freedom, which is also a claim for gender equality. That is, both principles might be motivating the same kind of demand or request for either recognition, accommodation, exemption. So these are really, in a way, the brave new world in which we live, and I want to suggest to you, first of all, that it's fascinating. Second, that it's actually quite difficult to address. So in terms of the approaches that we have seen, I'll just place my approach before I go into any details. I want to suggest to you that a lot of the kind of jurisprudential preferences or exhibited preferences that we find, at least in the U.S. Supreme Court, so going back actually to the question that was raised earlier, to some extent the U.S. Supreme Court and many justices throughout the U.S. legal system and also legal academia have taken a very strong preference for a winner-takes-all approach, which, and it's a doctrinal approach. That is, it means that one side will win and one side will lose. And you can see once we're talking about these intersecting or these multi-layered kinds of claims, this means that you have to make a very difficult choice. And I want to suggest to you that beyond the US, there's actually a tremendously rich experience now with what's referred to as the world of new constitutionalism, where this winner-takes-all methodological conception is actually rejected. That is, there's a serious attempt to try and find more flexibility, to try and find more context-sensitive kind of responses. And by doing this, the attempt is to find what are referred to as balancing mechanisms. Proportionality is one example of that. And really, these open a whole new way to address these kinds of conflicting claims. And in part, what I'll present later on is a more institutional model, which I will call regulated interaction, fits within this more flexible kind of an approach, trying to really recognize not just one value, but if possible, two or three, depending on what's the competition. So what I'll do in the second part of my talk, I'll quickly sketch one such approach, which I'll refer to as regulated interaction. And again, I just want to try to work through both the principles and the institutional dimension, that is to try and challenge the very assumption that by granting consideration, say, to religious diversity and gender equality, I want to challenge the assumption that we can't do both together and that we inevitably are forced to choose one over another. As I said, that's the winner-take-all kind of a mentality, and I want to try and challenge that. It's not an easy challenge, but I think it's one that's worth pursuing. And part of what I'll do, just as a concrete example, I'll talk a little bit about family law, just because this is a casebook illustration now to many of these really broiling and complicated challenges that we're seeing in the sense of the intersection of gender equality and religious diversity in many parts of the world. And again, given that I want to find these alternative models, I will suggest that instead of an either your rights or your culture kind of a solution or predicament, I want to place women, religious women, at the center of the analysis. And I'm thinking about them as citizens, as mothers, social and political activists, human rights bearers, dreamers, members of the faith. You can add whichever one you want, but just really just to mention some of their multiple responsibilities and affiliations. And I want to say that if we actually place these agents at the center of our analysis, then the picture really shifts. It's, for example, the winner-takes-all approach just doesn't work for them because the kinds of claims or difficulties that they have really occur because of these intersecting commitments that they might have to their faith and to their claims for greater equality. Within the faith to a demand or hope that their religious minority community itself would be included within the wider sphere. So by definition, their claims are multiple. And inevitably, if we deal with these issues, we also have to deal with a side issue, or some would say a very central issue, which is the question of who speaks for a culture, what happens if there are multiple voices, and once these kinds of debates or discussions reach the courts, what are the courts to do if there are multiple interpretations? Should they ever intervene in these kinds of debates, and if so, how? And again, if we'll have time, I'll speak about that. If not, ask me during the Q&A. And third and finally, if we have some time, I'll just give you some examples, not just family law, education, succession of political power, contracts. There are many, many fields of law where these kinds of intersections do occur. So that's our plan, and all of that will be done in 35 minutes or so, I hope. Okay, so let me just first go back to the distinction between the two kinds of claims, just really to make sure that we're all on the same page. So the claim for fair inclusion, I'm assuming, is relatively familiar in the room. I'll just give you one concrete legal example, a recent one. It just really nicely illustrates the notion of fair inclusion. So this is a case which came before the Supreme Court of Canada in 2006. It's called Multani. And it's a case in which a young Sikh student, who was a new immigrant to Canada, came to Canada, settled with his family in Quebec, and he came to school and he was carrying the kirpan. It's a small ceremonial dagger, which for believers is seen as one of the five Ks, the five main things that you have to follow as part of the Sikh faith. And he came to school with this kirpan, and it's actually underneath one's clothes, so no one knew about it. But one afternoon, that dagger fell, and it fell, and everyone saw it in the playground. And the school that he went to had a very strict policy, which said no kinds of weapons or dangerous objects are permitted in the school. And then the question became, is this kirpan, is this small dagger, is this potentially a weapon? Or is this a religious symbol? And this is pretty much what the whole debate was about. There were expert witnesses which were brought in. Everyone talked about it, and they were trying to understand how to interpret this kind of again, an object. The school said it's a dangerous weapon. That was their claim. And the other parties, which were the student, his parents, members of the Sikh community, which were interveners, they said that it's an important, they classified the dagger as an important religious symbol, and therefore one which should, the child should be permitted to carry to school. So this was the debate. It went on, came all the way out to the Supreme Court of Canada. The Sikh child, that is the student, failed in all lower courts, but when the case came to the Supreme Court of Canada after hearing the evidence, the court actually ruled in favor of the student. And I want to tell you why. I want you to hear the reasons, because they're really quite fascinating. And their argument was that holding the decision to ban the kirpan was not the least drastic means. That is, you can think about different ways in which the state, or in that particular case, the province of Quebec, could have responded. This was not the least drastic means to address the potential harm. So they didn't deny the fact that there was a potential harm, just their response. And they weighed it, they had to weigh the sincerity of the belief of this particular student, which was seen as sincere, and also the fact that the state's interference, the ban, was not trivial. So these are the kinds of considerations that courts are permitted to do, and then they held in favor of Multani, the student. But I want you to hear the court's words, not my description of it, and here it is. The court said the following: the argument that the wearing of the kirpans should be prohibited because the kirpan is a symbol of violence and because it sends the message of using that using force is necessary to assert rights and resolve conflict must fail. So this was the school's argument. Not only is this assertion contradicted by the evidence regarding the symbolic nature of the kirpan, it is also disrespectful, disrespectful, this is a powerful word from a court, disrespectful to believers in the Sikh religion and does not take into account constitutional values based on multiculturalism. Now granted, this is Canada, so. It's quite a different discourse from what Shayla described, right, in terms of the European courts and even the European courts of human rights. This is a majority decision, and indeed some of the most distinguished judges that we have in our court fully agreed with it. So just one description or one strong illustration of the claim for fair inclusion. Now, what cases like Multani do is they permit inclusion in the public sphere, or those who seek inclusion, fair inclusion in the public sphere, an opportunity to do so, but without necessarily losing identity-based markers that they see as significant, right? So it could be religious-based, cultural-based, group-based, but definitely the notion here is that you can come to the public sphere, be a full member in the public sphere, but without having to lose something that's very central to how you conceive your own identity. And just if you want to think about this, if you think about it in the words of Iris Young, for example, she would say it's a heterogeneous public in which persons stand forth with their differences acknowledged and respected. And again, this is acknowledged and respected in our encounters as citizens in shared political space. So this is really the fair inclusion line. As I said, it's a more familiar one. And the only thing that I want to point out is that if fully accepted, clearly this is not a trivial claim. That is, it does have the potential to make the public sphere different, right? It would be less uniform, it will be more pluralistic. And arguably, this is precisely the reason why we are seeing some of the resistance even to this more minimal claim, the claim for fair inclusion. And again, especially the European countries are clearly resisting these kinds of fair inclusion claims now. And I want to suggest that in part, it might be the reinterpretation by some members of the majority community that this is actually not a trivial claim. That is, that what it might challenge is the claim or the cultural kinds of claims that the majority could raise, right? It would be their collective histories, identities, perhaps even privileges that might be reduced or challenged through this enlarged and more diverse vision of the public sphere. So partly I would read, say, the hijab cases as falling into that kind of a response, right? The political response of majorities actually saying, we have our own culture too. It's not just a minority's claim. I actually see that as a very, very dangerous turn, because if the arguments that are raised in favor of cultural recognition for minorities are turned around and reappropriated by the majorities, this could be a very, very unpleasant kind of scenario for minorities. And I fear that, for example, if we get the cases, the current niqab bans, the face covering bans, if they go all the way up to the European Court of Human Rights, I'm not at all sure that they would not accept some kind of a cultural majoritarian claim saying this is France, this is Belgium, this is who we are. And I think that would be just a very dangerous precedent. And given that the court in Laozi, which is the case of the crucifix in Italy, we can talk about that later on, the court actually accepted a very creative theory of what crucifix can stand for, which Italy said they were universal and inclusive, so who knows what they might do with these claims of culture. So just to say, all of these debates, the fair inclusion debates, are deeply textual, and they're textured, and they're rich, and they're multi-layered, and they're complicated. So if this is not complicated enough, I want to suggest that there is this new challenge that we're facing, and it's on the horizon, and that's the privatized diversity or the enclave diversity kind of claim. And there are different manifestations of this challenge. The way in which I want to phrase it to you, or the example that I will use, is when we're seeing self-proclaimed guardians of the faith, again, I'm talking just about religious minority communities, seeking to establish or encourage, gently or not, members of the minority community to turn to private arbitration tribunals. These are non-state institutions, they're not public courts, and these are institutions which are legal in most, at least in most common law countries. You can enter them through a contractual agreement, a consensual agreement between two parties. You write a contract which says that now you're turning to arbitration, and whatever the arbitrator decides becomes binding. This is actually occurring all the time, for sure in New York City, but in any other part of the world as well. This is a very standard procedure now. So if you want your sort of law 101 or 102 kind of moment, each and every one of you could actually become an arbitrator. There's no requirement of legal knowledge, there's no requirement of legal training. As I said, it's fully based on the idea of individual autonomy and consent. If the two parties consent and turn to any one of you as the third party who will be their arbitrator, and the contract is held to be valid, then not only is your decision standing as a final and binding decision, it will also be enforced through our civil court system. So this is a whole just development of switch or change that we're seeing in our law, irrespective of religious claims, just a rise of privatized kinds of dispute resolution. But my concern is that once this institutional option is available, you can imagine the kinds of concern that might arise if we actually add concerns about power inequities, if we add possible coercion that occurs within religious communities, or just, again, various ways of encouraging parties to turn to these kinds of alternative institutions. And as I said, they are, on the face of it, they are legal and permitted. So this is partly the reason why this is such a serious challenge, because the way in which at least some proponents of these privatized tribunals are raising them is precisely in order to avoid or shield the decisions of these tribunals from constitutional challenges or from the application of international human rights or standards. So this is quite a serious way of really bringing to the fore claims of hands-off approach or non-interventionist set of claims vis-a-vis the state, which could never pass if this were had to go through the standard process of primary legislation, for example. No chance that it would pass, say, in Canada or in other countries, in this country. However, we are seeing this occurring in a way through the back door, and that's why I want to refer to it as a back door, because if this had been debated under standard kinds of legislation procedures or democratic procedures that we have, it probably wouldn't have not passed, but it is occurring on the ground. And I want to suggest that it's a real storm to come. That is, we have to address it, and I'll just give you some examples or indications to why I think it's so central. It's central because it brings three contested kinds of tensions and claims that we have in our societies. Obviously, claims of religion, religious freedom, claims of gender equality, and it's also that just the rise of private justice is deeply connected to the rise of the neoliberal state. It's just all these things are deeply interconnected. And if you just want to have concrete examples, we had a very acrimonious debate in Canada, which really followed precisely the lines of what I've described to you, a more conservative Muslim religious group, a more conservative self-defined conservative group, which wanted to create one of these tribunals called the Dar al-Qada. It was a big public debate. At the end of the day, despite the fact that normally you could actually turn to such a tribunal, because this became such a political debate, the legislation was changed, and now we have a prohibition. You cannot turn to such parties, third parties, to arbitrate your debate if it's a family law dispute. So it's a very specific prohibition which applies to all religions, not just to Islam. It applies across the board. So even if there was previously a Beth Din, a Jewish Beth Din, it can no longer operate as a binding institution. I'll tell you later on, you can actually still have these contracts going on, and they're mediated, which, unless you know a lot about the law, means that the state would not enforce it. But the chance that someone who actually had an agreement signed and perhaps had their imam or rabbi sign it, and the assumption that they would know that is really quite a stretch. I mean, I teach one of my courses in my law school. I teach a course in professionalism and ethics, and I always ask my students a question about mediation and arbitration, and they're smart kids, and they always fail it because it's so difficult, even if you have the legal knowledge. So assuming that someone who doesn't know would have the ability to really have these very fine legal skills to know whether or not it's binding is, I think, a bit of a stretch. Now, just in the sense of where this is also occurring, Carol mentioned the Archbishop of Canterbury. Actually, and he had, a beautiful speech, not because he mentioned my work, but because it's actually a very sophisticated, nuanced elaboration of his vision of what might be the relationship between religious law and secular law in England. But one of the things which he proposed or he raised was the option of thinking about non-state kind of tribunals, which would apply potentially some version of Sharia law. And I don't like that expression because it's actually extremely hard to use a definition of what Sharia stands for. But his vision or what was picked up from that particular lecture was this notion of saying perhaps we will have these kinds of institutions in England. And you remember there was criticism from right, left, center, pretty much the whole political array. So that's one concrete example. In the US, there's actually a very strange manifestation of this kind of debate, which is occurring negatively. That is, some states are proactively, I think Aziz al-Hibri mentioned this, are proactively legislating against the use of either Islamic law or, interestingly enough, international law as well. So they have this combination. These are the two big dangers that we're facing, or presumably this country is facing. So just to give you a sense, these are very real live debates. And in a way, it's very good that they're live debates, because the concern with precisely this kind of a procedure is precisely the fact that it's actually hidden. You don't actually see it. So it's, in a way, I'm very pleased that these are public debates, because then at least we can have a conversation about it. So I've given you, hopefully, enough information about these kinds of procedures. You're welcome to ask me a little bit more about it during the Q&A, but I want you to, hopefully, I've convinced you that there's a real danger here, that this presumably just procedural technical change of moving the discussion from the public court to these private institutions is not just a trivial kind of a move. It's actually deeply dangerous. It could rewrite or reshape the relationship between state and religion, again, in states which officially do not permit religious law to have any binding kind of status. And I want to suggest that it is something that we should seriously think about. Now, in terms of criticizing the privatized diversity claim, I think the easiest route to take is just to suggest that the weakest link of this type of an argument is to suggest that some institutions or some communities should have unfettered power. They should be free from any kind of constitutional or international regulation. And even if we accept the argument for non-intervention on grounds of allowing associational freedom, for example, allowing associational communities as much freedom as possible to pursue their own vision of the good in a diverse society, this commitment in and of itself is not unlimited. That is, it doesn't make the argument. That is, you can say that even if there's a strong argument of religious liberty, as I've already mentioned earlier on, itself has certain limits in constitutional democracies. It could be restricted by other liberties, by other rights, by other claim holders. So even if you claim that you have associational freedom, that doesn't do enough of the work. And I also want to suggest that, given that we live in a world where there's so much interaction among different legal system, thus the notion of suggesting that you could just have an island of jurisdiction which is absolutely unaffected by anything else in and of itself is not just unrealistic, it's also unconvincing, and I want to say normatively unattractive. That is, no state is an island. States themselves now, and we heard from Shayla, themselves are subject to various layers of regulation which occur sometimes with their consent, sometimes without their consent, right? If states consent to a particular agreement, it's not a problem, but we sometimes even have some transnational norms which would be binding even if you've not consented to them. So this applies to states, which we take their sovereignty and their self-determination to be quite serious. So in such a world, it would be just inconsistent to suggest that then minority communities can come and say, we can have this unbelievably strong kind of a protection just by virtue of us wishing to do so. So it's a much more complicated world in which we live, and we have these intersecting and these competing, in some certain cases overlapping, in certain cases indeed conflicting sources of law and authority and identity. They could be at the most subnational level, national, regional, international, and we're seeing all of these interactions occurring. So it's just in such a world, it's an incredible claim to suggest that all of a sudden we need to just ignore all of these issues and artificially create now a very clean kind of Mondrian-like, clean, very clear lines. Here is the yellow, here is the red, here is the white. We just don't live in that kind of a world. It's much more intersecting now. And I want to suggest that the real challenge that this raises then for constitutional democracies is not just to necessarily jump to a conclusion, which perhaps some of you are thinking, which is just to say, do what Canada did, just ban, just say, this is not permitted, period. I'll come in a minute to the reasons why I think this is not necessarily the best kind of a route as a practical matter. But still, we're left with the challenge of defining how much room, what kind of degree of accommodation or exemption ought to be given in pluralistic societies. So the fact that we have these multiple layers or sources of authority still doesn't give us an answer of what's the right kind of balance that we have to draw between these competing claims. And that indeed is really the kind of challenge that we're facing today. So just going back to the privatized diversity debate that I've mentioned to you, clearly, hopefully, you're convinced that I'm not too sympathetic to this line of argument, at least in its extreme articulation. It's a claim for exclusion, and even if it's a claim for self-exclusion, it doesn't make it more legitimate. So I think it would be the kind of automatic response, or the kind of, in a way, a logical response is to say, well, we'll just prohibit this kind of an action. We'll prohibit it because there are so many policy considerations to suggest that it's potentially injurious to some group members, and particularly to more vulnerable group members. If you're thinking about family law, all your concerns about gender equality would be heightened and exaggerated and inflated in a way in this kind of a forum. So there are good arguments to suggest that perhaps this is not a legitimate route. But then I want to suggest to you that just the notion of simply imposing a legal ban, or saying that we're going to, we here speaking as a state or a regional entity, to say this is not permitted, private ordering, say, in family matters is not permitted, would just not make these issues disappear. All that it would do is would just push them underground. So this would, you would have precisely the same kinds of, not precisely the same kind, we actually don't know what the empirical evidence is. That is, we can assume that at least some members, precisely the members who are more coerced to turn to these religious institutions, alternative dispute resolution institutions in the first place, would continue to be pressured to turn to now these unauthorized, unregularized, in a way invisible institutions, which do exist but are not registered in any kind of public discourse, or indeed in any kind of public document. And I want to suggest that if we do that, we might really be placing at a more vulnerable position precisely those individuals which really might need the constitutional protections that we have, or the international human rights kinds of remedies that we have. They're not perfect, but they're definitely better than not having anything at all. And I want to suggest that especially female members of very juristic-centered religions, and as it happens, in the context of our discussion, say if we are thinking about the UK or Canada and the US, Judaism and Islam are deeply juristic, or deeply legalistic kinds of communities. So I want to suggest that women who belong to these communities, if they continue to turn to now these absolutely unauthorized, unregularized, as I said, invisible kinds of institutions, they might be hit particularly hard, because it would be very hard for them to fend for themselves if they have the courage or the ability to even challenge one of these decisions. Their ability to do so would be really limited, because none of this is occurring as part of what we know as our formal law. So given that I don't think that the standard secular systems response, which is either to legislate away these privatized diversity challenges, or simply to ignore the problem, that's another solution. This is what the UK is doing. The UK is actually the country that has the most established Sharia councils, as they are called in the UK, unofficial bodies of decision making, which are not recognized, but clearly everyone knows that they are in existence, and indeed a growing number of women are turning to them. So this is really a quite an interesting story, which we could look into later on. But just the idea of either ignoring these kinds of practices or legislating them away, I want to suggest to you that perhaps at the symbolic level, they might have a value, but if we're worried about the protection of more vulnerable members, they might not do the job. And in fact, they might have exactly the opposite an effect of disempowering precisely these women who need more protections, and reinforcing their vulnerability. And all of this is done in the name of protecting their rights. So it's a serious concern that we have. And again, just looking specifically at Judaism and Islam, so the way in which this could occur as a practical matter, if we're thinking about family law, you would have a woman who entered her marriage through the religious route, which in most countries, if you enter the religious route, it's actually also recognized as a civil marriage. So you would have both a civil status, a religious status. All that the state can do is terminate the civil status, assuming that there's a breakdown in the relationship, but you would still need to get the get from a religious institution if you're looking for, if you want to get the release from an Islamic marriage. You would need probably, if your husband is refusing, you'll have to use the khula kind of procedure. So these are real complicated issues which only religious institutions can provide, because remember, we're talking about states which officially are divorced from religion. They can't provide these kinds of remedies. So this is why these are complicated issues. There are also financial matters. If you're thinking about the mahr, should it or should it not be permitted to be enforced? And I want to suggest that if we want to grant the same freedoms that we grant all other women in a society, that is the ability to break up their families or to enter a new relationship, or any of these kinds of protections that women have should apply across the board, including and should affect also members of religious minority communities. And separating, just treating these two as occurring on totally different spheres, is not the best way necessarily of addressing their claims. So how am I doing with time? 5 minutes. Okay, so I'll have to tell you all of my responses in 5 minutes. This will be very telegraphic. So I want to suggest that if we want to try and find ways to accommodate diversity with equality, as I suggested earlier on, and if we want to include as many players as we can, the individual, the community, the state, regional, transnational, all these kinds of players should be in the mix. Again, trying to recognize women as religious members, as well as holding these intersecting and potentially conflicting affiliations to both identity and norm-creating traditions, then we have to think creatively. So here's what I'm going to do. I'll do this telegraphically. So there are different kinds of ways of thinking about this. The first and the easiest one, in a way, is to think about potentials for change within the community. I'm a big believer in that. So you could think about women having access to the sacred texts of a particular tradition, which they have historically never had, and through that kind of reinterpretive work, really just find or reveal or create more gender-friendly or human rights-friendly or enforcing kinds of interpretations in these traditions. It's absolutely possible, at least in these very legalistic traditions. They just have such a variety of tools of interpretation. The only trick would be that you really have to be familiar with the hermeneutical type of moves that you're permitted to make. So you would have to be credible internally in terms of the work that you do. But there's no reason to assume that if you have access to these sources of knowledge that you shouldn't be able to do that. So that's an internal kind of a solution, which is, in many ways, I'm optimistic about it. It is already occurring on the ground. The only issue with it is that's a very, very long-term kind of a solution. And the question is, do we just want to wait, or do we want to do something in the intermediate kind of a period? But I think it is quite an optimistic, or at least that's one source of optimism. I also want to suggest to you that some countries are even engaging in a process which tries to motivate these more human rights enforcing interpretations, but I think it's actually quite a tricky business. South Africa, for example, I mentioned earlier, does this with reference to its customary laws, which are now recognized under the new South African constitution. So you have to actually acknowledge customary laws, but the provision is that it has to operate within the boundaries of the constitution. And then the complex issues occur when there's a dispute within the community about which tradition, which kind of an interpretation of a tradition should prevail, one which is referred to as the living tree, which is a more progressive kind of interpretation, or the more traditional interpretation, which the court, at least in South Africa, has ruled in favor of the living tree, which is the more progressive interpretation. So you can see it as a great victory. There's also a deep concern for backlash, because then it's not necessarily just an internal kind of a discussion. So we can talk about that later on. So these are two kinds of internal or internal plus external solutions. The regulated interaction solutions really try and do two things. You can think about them as operating on two different spheres. One really would be to try and identify within each kind of a dispute, like the intersecting disputes that I've mentioned to you earlier, just to try and see what's the most salient issue which the parties are seeking to find. If it doesn't overlap absolutely, then you can think about this as a Venn diagram. So some issues really might be the state, some might be the religions, some might be intersecting, and you could really limit the debate in the first place. And secondly, you could actually find resolutions, and I'm happy to give you lots of examples about how this is actually done in practice. Many disputes which seem absolutely to be irreconcilable. If you actually do this breakdown work from the harm up, very context specific, what are the kinds of disputes? If you really try and map it out, you'll find that in many cases there are more opportunities for finding solutions which are win-win kinds of solutions. Again, I don't want to oversell it, but there is that possibility. And in fact, if any of you are familiar with, even just with an example which has nothing to do with religion, just international schools, say in this city, for example, really follow this model of intersecting Venn diagrams. That is, when we were here in New York, our son went to the British school. His curriculum was fully governed by an institution which sits in England. But everything else about that school was governed by New York state law and city law, as it should be. That is the question of immunization, safety, a lack of abuse, reporting of abuse. All of these things were done here locally. So that's one kind of a question of how do you define which institution or which entity has the authority. That's precisely where the complexities are. But on the ground, we actually see this occurring all the time, various creative kinds of solutions. So that's just one concrete example. I'm happy to talk about family law, but just in the interest of time, I'll just tell you one second dimension of resolving these kinds of disputes. And here we can just turn to the good old public court system. That is, our courts have a real sophisticated way of dealing with very complex legal issues. And one of the things which have been done, and this is actually coming most of it, say, from France, the Netherlands, cases where traditional kinds of contractual and torts remedies have been used, say, to address the get problem, abuse of right in France. It's a very familiar terminology that you could use, has been applied to the kind of harm that a woman who's not divorced by her husband, if she wishes to do so, can turn to. In Canada, we've seen contractual mechanism. You can just say that there's a breach of the civil side of a contract has been breached. The court will never do what the courts in New York actually do, which is specific performance. The court, at least in Canada, would never enforce a religious party to take a religious obligation. But you can say that the breach of that obligation has civil ramifications, which we have various ways of addressing. So I want to suggest to you that if we're willing to let go of the notion that we have to choose either one value or just one winner and one loser, and actually begin to think more creatively, institutionally, to reflect the real dilemmas that women experience because they are already affected by these intersecting or overlapping systems, then I think there's a much, much greater room for creativity and also for finding solutions to what appear to be problems that are just irreconcilable. And I'll just close with the notion of entangled. That is, although our intuition is to suggest that the best solution is to separate the sphere, that's the traditional secularist response, I want to suggest that the notion of disentanglement might work for certain kinds of discussions or debates or circumstances, but it's not always automatically the only solution that we should consider. There are cases where precisely the recognition of the entanglement, what I've referred to as these Venn diagrams, is precisely what we need to do. And that might actually permit greater freedom and greater protection of rights to those who really need that kind of protection. And no doubt, there will be many, many kinds of resistance or rejections of this kind of an approach. For sure, extremists within religious minority communities would see this as a corruption of the faith and the faithful. People who hold a very, very strong notion of strict separation might also reject this kind of an idea which permits more entanglement than the traditional way of thinking about these issues. And it's clearly a delicate balance to achieve, but I want to suggest to you, despite the various obstacles, political will obstacles, various other obstacles that we will face, what I'm proposing, again, being the legal utopian here, is not a blueprint for any immediate kind of an implementation, and I'll just close with that. So I have no idea, no kind of vision that this will happen tomorrow morning, but if we don't explore the power of ideas, that is, if we don't try and expand what is seen as the universe of the possible, and rewrite the potential set of options, conceivable options for action, then change will never occur. So I want to suggest that even though I'm not expecting any of this to happen tomorrow morning, without any thought about how change or visions of change, change will never occur. So I'll close with that. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Carissa. Use the mic. Wait, he's going to give it to you. Please say your name.
My name is Carissa Velis. I'm from the Graduate Center from Philosophy. Thank you for your wonderful talk. I feel very sympathetic to your approach. And one question I had, I agree that focusing on the individual, like these women you were mentioning that are part of minority groups and religious and mothers and et cetera, really shifts the view. And one question I have is whether there should be some hierarchy with these categories. Is it more important that they are first and foremost citizens or minorities, or should these categories be completely equal and we should take an approach more like holistic approach to the individual? I mean, is this a solution or is it part of the problem being hierarchy?
No, it's a great question. I don't think you could have a predefined hierarchy, although to some extent, the way in which once you work with international human rights and you're working with citizenship rights, in effect, you are working with a hierarchy, right? Because these are already predefined. But I think in this model, at least, you would definitely want to have the agents themselves participate in the definition of these intersecting identities. But my assumption is, at least in rejecting the privatized diversity approach, I do want to suggest that it would be very artificial to just suggest that as a person who lives today in the 21st century, that some of us could just say, but I'm really insulating myself to all of these effects of the law. And I might have very good reasons to do so, but even if this exemption could occur, it would have to be extremely narrow. So to some extent, I am assuming the overlapping kind of affiliation as a basic structure of this model, but it's more fluid. That's why it's not a hierarchy. And especially if you're thinking about this as Venn diagrams, you know, they could move, they could shift, you might have to add another one. So I wouldn't take a strong hierarchy, but I would say that by definition, once you are working with existing norms, they themselves actually shape your discussion to some extent.
Sorry, Kislevsky.
Thanks. Hi, I'm Sari Kislevsky from Law and Philosophy, so I think my question's a bit of both. I wanted to pick up on your comment about drawing on family law, and I was wondering if you could generalize from the model of family law. So family law historically has been an area that was previously thought to be private, right? The law had the courts had no business in it, and we've seen the law develop into an extremely nuanced and sensitive set of rules, right, that govern, that kind of interact with ordinary family life in a way that tries to protect all the parties, right? And we've seen it grow so as to expand our notion of family also, right, in all kinds of interesting ways. So that I would have thought that would be a very good model for the kind of thing that you're talking about. That's what struck me when you were describing the problem.
So no, definitely, I work a lot with family law, first of all, because some of the intersections, some of the hardest questions do arise there. But I also agree with you that if you look at the history, it's actually a fascinating history, and one which does permit you to definitely to see change over time. So even just to take the narrowest kind of a response would be to say, for sure the changes have occurred there. And also, historically, this was more the realm of the church than the state, right, if you look at Western societies, at least. So so this is... So in a way, you're saying, why does the privatized diversity challenge even arise, if I understand you correctly? Oh, yeah, for sure. No, I think that, again, I don't know if it would, you know, just to say it's a model is a bit strong, but it is one example among many. That is, I think that's why I brought in also the education example, and you can think about various other examples as well, where you do see a sense of greater involvement. But I personally think that the family law example is a very powerful one, and precisely for the reasons that you have raised. We know that there was a lot, you know, state laws historically were the ones that were heavily discriminating against women. Women were not even recognized as legal entities under the coverture tradition in British law and common law. So it's not that this story is only happy, but for sure it required a good amount of feminist work and social mobilization and changes in the law to make this a more inclusive, and this is still partly a work in progress, for sure, in this country, right? So the question of whose rights are protected, who can even qualify as a member of a family, and what kind of rights and obligations apply between the parties and them towards third parties if children are involved. Yeah, I think I agree. It is a very good model. But I would just want to qualify that to some extent. The reason why I'm saying it's not necessarily a real model is that each realm, you would really want to look at it and see what kinds of tensions and issues arise. But I think as a working example, it's a wonderful one.
Okay, Nanette.
Yeah, I want to speak also about the family law issue and the example you give of how this regulated interaction can help, that the court can, in a sense, the civil court can confirm that if the man has agreed to give a gift and that's in the divorce contract, then it's binding. But your example there, it was interesting because then they couldn't carry through with it in any way, so in the end it didn't really help the woman when there was an attempt not to carry through with giving the git. but also it was an example in which the woman's rights weren't at risk because the husband was agreeing to give the git. So I'm wondering, how can this regulated interaction actually help when there's a real threat to the woman's right and that the husband won't, in some sense, cooperate? Would you say that the court, the civil court, can require that kind of behavior, that in this case, that the husband agrees to the religious divorce?
We could talk about this for quite a while, so I'll give you the abbreviated version. It really depends on the circumstances. That is, the case that I was referring to, actually the Canadian case, is a Supreme Court of Canada case called Markovitz versus Brooker versus Markovitz. And that was a case where the civil divorce agreement was based on a prior contractual agreement between the parties. One of the provision was a provision of the husband turning to the Beth Din and granting the wife a get. And that provision was introduced into the civil contract, into the contract which later on the civil divorce was based upon. That's the first step in this particular story. The second step which happened was after the husband had the civil divorce, he said, true, I signed this contract, but this is just a moral obligation. It's not a legal obligation. And I'll just complicate the story a little bit more. This is a case that came from Quebec, and Quebec, the contract law in Quebec is subject to civil law, and civil law actually differentiates between a moral and a legal obligation. A moral obligation is one which you cannot enforce. So this became a serious issue. That is, if it's a moral obligation, it really cannot be enforceable, at least not through the courts. So this case, again, like all the other ones I've told you, filtered around for quite a few years in the legal system. The husband refused to grant the get for about 10 years or so, and he was winning in the lower courts. But then for a host of reasons, which were, no one is really clear how directly related they were to the legal proceeding, he decided to grant his wife the get. So that issue was resolved by the time the case came before the Supreme Court of Canada. But the Supreme Court of Canada still had to make the call whether this was a moral or a legal obligation. And they said in this kind of a context, because it was so central for the wife agreeing to sign, and for the civil court in the first place, granting the civil divorce, the only way to really treat this particular individual, this woman, equally is to think about this as a civil standard legal obligation in a contract. And the husband was ordered to pay quite significant remedies to the wife. Again, now not for the fact that he refused to get, because by that time he already granted it, but just because he breached a contract. And anyone who breaches a contract actually is subject to these kinds of remedies if they're sued. So the court was playing a very kind of a delicate game. They were fortunate they didn't have to get to the question of specific performance because it was already executed in a way the get was given. But they were trying to suggest that they could do this kind of a separation even if another case came to the fore. And another way to think about this is just to legislate these kinds of relationship. That is, you could say that you would have a pre-requirement of turning to a religious authority. There are different mechanisms that different countries have used. But I think the specific performance, the reason why I would want to try and rule it out is because that really requires a deep entanglement of the secular authority in an act which, all in all, the status component per se for Jewish law, for example, really would be more of a religious realm per se, not a state, unless you're in Israel, right? But if you're talking about countries which have this strict separation, then you would want to maintain some degree of autonomy, so to speak, of the state from the religion and the religion from the state. So the question of what's overlapping and what is not, to some extent, is the hardest question in all of these models. That's why I said also earlier on, family law is a great example, but in other spheres, you might have a different set of interactions.
I'm afraid we only have time for one more in the back. Yeah.
Hi, Abby Ruane, Hunter College. I really enjoyed your concept of entanglement and disentanglement, and I was wondering if you had looked at some of the work from peace studies, feminist peace studies like Galtung, Katia Confortini does some work in that area, and conflict transformation that talks about connecting issues as a way for creative change. I feel like it resonates a lot with what you've talked about. And in that regard, going back to a question earlier on Sheila Ben Habib's talk about the recognizing power in discourse, I was wondering if those kinds of discussions with feminist peace studies and conflict transformation might be an opportunity to link both of your talks and dealing with how to navigate power issues in discourse. I was just wondering what you thought about that.
Do you want me to? I'm not sufficiently familiar with that literature, but the conflict transformation I am familiar with, and you're right, it is partly the same kind of a logic of trying to take a very violent kinds of disagreements, or indeed deep violence, and trying to transform it into some kind of a new form of engagement. So I think power inevitably plays a very central role. First of all, you need to get to a position where the different parties are willing to even engage peacefully, right? That's a very significant moment to begin with. And then once you have that, the question of how to transform the conflict is a significant one. But I would just want to suggest that at least in these kinds of examples that we have discussed today, and you're right that we could expand it to the transnational realm as well, the procedural requirement, which you probably would want to insist upon as a matter of just ensuring representation, is to say that you want to have for sure within each represented community, if this is a kind of negotiated settlement, you would want to have representatives of sub-communities of a given community. So for example, if you're thinking about indigenous communities and you're thinking about the question of women within those indigenous communities, they have very specific interests which sometimes are well represented by their male leaders and sometimes are not. So you would want to ensure, for example, that you had a contingency of, say, female indigenous members of whatever negotiating party. You would want to perhaps even break it down more specifically if you know there's something about the potential vulnerability or indeed the kind of past harms. So I would want the most harmed party to definitely be there and speak as directly as possible, even if there is a form of representation. It's not going to be direct democracy necessarily, but if you want to at least have agents who can speak on behalf of a contingency that you can predictably expect, either based on historical experience or just based on the kind of power relations, that contingency would be the one that has a real stake, a deep stake in these kinds of resolutions, and just the assumption that someone else could speak on their behalf. I would be very worried about it and weary of accepting it.
Okay, well, both of our distinguished speakers have agreed to come in to our reception where you can talk to them personally. We'll be on the fifth floor. Please join me in thanking Ayelet. Very stimulating, and also Shayla. Thank you both.